church on fire. This is the Holy Spirit flame. We have a burning desire to lift up Jesus' name.
Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
Romans chapter 8 says, "For many are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God." As many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. One of the greatest privileges we have in the body of Christ is being believers, being born of the Spirit, knowing God, is that we can be led by the Spirit. See, people outside the church don't have the right to be led by the Spirit. Can you say hallelujah? Thank God we do. Thank God we have the opportunity for the Spirit of God to speak to us. Thank God we have the means whereby the Spirit of God can minister life to us. He can lead us and guide us. Everybody say glory to God. And see, you have the Holy Ghost in you, and he leads and guides you. Can you say amen to that? So, we read on down here in verse 15. He says, but if, I was reading the wrong book. For as many are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself, or himself, bears witness with our spirit that we are the sons or children of God. Thank God we're the children of God. Now, because we're the children of God, we have the Holy Ghost in us. Say, thank God I got the Holy Ghost in me. Every born-again believer has the Spirit within. If you're born again, whether you're baptized with the Holy Ghost or not, you have the witness or the indwelling Spirit. Now, there is an experience referred to in the Bible as the infilling or baptism of the Holy Spirit, and that is subsequent to the new birth. But if you're born again, you have the witness of the Spirit within your spirit. Hallelujah. If you know you're a child of God, we know we've passed from death unto life because we love the brethren, but the Spirit of God bears witness with our spirit that we're the children of God. Can you say amen? So we have the Holy Ghost. I've got the Holy Ghost indwelling me. He's my guide. He's the one who leads me. Hallelujah. And here what Paul wrote to the church at Rome and said, if you are led by the Spirit, you're a child of God. They're led by the Spirit of God, the sons of God. In other words, when you learn to follow the witness or the leading of the Spirit, you've reached a stage of maturity. Say maturity. Because you're no longer led by your flesh or by whims. You're led by the Spirit. See, whims can come along. Doctrines can come along. New teachings can come along. But the Holy Ghost is the same. Amen. He'll still lead you and guide you. He'll still direct you. Now, we got some things we always give as parameters when we talk along these lines. He'll always lead you in line with the written word of God.
Right. Amen.
What if there's not a scripture that actually covers? You know, we don't have a scripture that says, Jeff, thou shalt go to Africa next week and be a missionary. And that's not written in the Bible. Obviously, there are things, but there are principles. That said, there are principles. We got people who are calling into the ministry. We have people, the Bible talks about people calling into the ministry. The Bible talks about, people being sent. How lovely on the mountains of them, how lovely on the mountains are the feet of them who preach the gospel of peace. And, you know, and the Bible talks about how that, I always try to get ahead of myself. It says, you know, that those who are sent, amen, those that are sent, you know, thank God they're sent ones. So we have principles of going out as a missionary. So then we have to ascertain, am I to go or not, by the witness of the Spirit. Sometimes it's witnessed or confirmed by presbytery, by others older you in the Lord. Many times it is. Actually, it should be. But, you know, I can't call you to Africa unless you have a witness of Africa first. Okay? So we have things where the Word of God covers specifically, and then there are things that the Word of God covers in principle. And if it covers in principle, then we have to get the specifics from being led by the Spirit. Amen? Oh, well. Hallelujah. She said, I'm bleeding. Must have hit my, I kind of stuck myself in this. Anyway, yeah, we'll live and not die. Amen. And don't bring out the trainer to take me up or something. Hallelujah. So, our spirit, now, we teach so many things along these different lines, like on the Word of God, you need to be fed the Word of God, you need to know the Word of God. It's going to be hard to know that you're bearing witness to at least a principle of the Word of God unless, you know what the Word says, and at least in principle. Right. Amen. You know, it's like one guy said, the Spirit of God doesn't lead you to take somebody else's wife. You know, just because you got a funny feeling don't mean it's the Holy Ghost. So that violates the principle of the written Word. If it violates the principle of the written Word, then you don't walk in it. Okay, I felt like one time we shared this a number of times over the years. We had a girl in the church, and she went to some Christian concert in Raleigh, and the next morning I get a phone call from the mother hysterical. We wasn't in a church sponsor thing. We didn't even advertise. They came and told me they were going to it. Right. Oh, okay, well have fun. Praise the Lord. Right. She's not home. Well, I don't know where they are. And then they finally find her, and then I got another phone call about how that, she said that God told her to go, saw these guys walking out of the building to go join themselves to them. They sat in the car all night and witnessed to them. I'm not sure how much witness it was going on. I don't want to judge that, but I'll tell you what, and I told them, I said, number one, I'll talk to her because that's not what we teach. I said, she's supposed to be honoring you. She should have, at minimum, told you where she was. Okay? The Bible says to honor your father and mother. God wouldn't tell you to go do something like that and then not tell you at the same time, go call your mom and dad, let them know where you are. You're not out all night long by yourself in the car with somebody and show up the next morning and your mom and dad are worried. So that violates the Word of God on honoring your parents. Okay? So I said, look, don't just understand. We don't teach that. We don't believe that. I said, she shouldn't have done that. I said, that's not how we operate around here. Amen. She came and told me, oh, God doesn't. No. God didn't tell you to go sit there, witness them all night, and did not contact your parents. God didn't tell you doodly squat. Yeah, you know how he goes down, so the guy gives the analyst and he got the color guy. Gives all the color analysis and all the fill-in stuff. There's Jeff, S-M-Y. Anyway, so we had a talk with her. She kept trying to defend. Yeah, God didn't tell you to do that. Why? Because it violates his word. The Spirit of God does not run contrawise to the written word. Now, if it's a principle of the Word of God, the Spirit of God can give you specifics and leadings and guidance in accordance with a principle of the written word. Can you say amen? Amen. All right. So, We are children of God. We have the inner witness of the Spirit. We have the Holy Ghost in us. Yes, there is an experience subsequent to the new birth called the baptism of the Holy Spirit. But I want you to know that if you're born again, you will still have the witness of the Spirit. I believe it's enhanced and more powerful and with greater clarity when you're baptized with the Holy Ghost. But I'm not going to tell you that if you're not baptized with the Holy Ghost in a Pentecostal experience that you can't hear from God. That's not true. That's it. If you teach that, you're not right. That's not accurate. Amen. All right? If you're born again, the Holy Ghost witnesses to you. Right. And he will lead you and guide you. Can you say amen? Amen. Now, our spirit has a witness or a knowing. Remember the Bible says that the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we're the children of God. Now, in the New Testament, believers are not to be led by the prophet, but by the Spirit. In the Old Testament, they were led by the prophet. Now, what do you mean by that? In the Old Testament, they had to go get a prophet to find out what they were supposed to do next. Because only the prophet, priest, and king had the Holy Ghost on them. Right. In the New Testament, we got them in us. Right. You don't need the prophet to tell you what to do. Right. People call up somebody at night. We had a friend down in Greenville, in our church in Greenville, and he was sitting around one night, and somebody called him up and said, Brother John! Said, yeah, he said, what's the word? We wonder if you got a word for us. They actually thought of him as dial a prophet. Now, number one, the prophet cannot function in unction unless the Holy Ghost unctions him. Right. Amen. The gifts of the Spirit are divided separate to every man as he wills. That that we have the unction comes. You just can't prophesy just because you want to prophesy. Now, you can say, thus saith the Lord. And you can say, woo, the Holy Ghost said. And it be you. It's got to be unction of the Spirit, which means you just can't call me up and say, Pastor Ed, got a word. Well, you know what you're going to get if you call me and ask me that question? What's the Bible say? What's the Word say? Because unless I have unction of the Holy Ghost, I just can't give you anything. And if you go out and act on what I give you out of my flesh, you can't get a spiritual result. Because there's no unction, there's no anointing in it. There's no power in it. Now, you can get counsel. You can get wisdom. Well, you know, I believe that the Word of God, but you can't come in here and say, Pastor Ed, you got a word, I say that this is going to happen, that's going to happen. You can't do that unless the anointing is on you to do it. And you can't walk in it unless the anointing was on it for you to do it. Amen. So what do? We walk according to the witness of the Spirit. We're not led by the prophet. And I'll tell you something, even if somebody prophesies of you, it better be something your spirit has. In the New Testament believer, they that are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. You got to have the witness of the Spirit. You got to have the Holy Ghost on the inside. You got to have the anointing of the Spirit speaking to you and speaking through you in order to walk in those things. Yeah. As if they were of God. And they, and what I say by that, if somebody lays hands on you and says, yea, thus saith the Lord, you're supposed to pack up your bags and move to China, you better know you're supposed to move to China. Or you better carry dial a prophet with you so he can tell you when to come home. Or at least have a cell phone number. No, we're led by the Spirit of God. New Testament believers have the Spirit of God within them. Guidance may come, but only to confirm what's already in your heart. Remember, over in Acts, the 5th chapter, 13th chapter, let's look over there. Acts chapter 13. Now there were at the church that was at Antioch certain prophets and teachers, as Barnabas and Simeon, which was called Niger, and Lucius and Cyrene and Manion, and which had been brought with Herod the Tetrarch and Saul. As they ministered unto the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, listen to this, we got a word from the Lord. Separate me, Barnabas and Saul for the work whereunto I have called them. Now that leads me to think they already had a knowing of the calling that was on them. Now the Holy Ghost said, now separate them to the work that I've already called them to. I have called them. Amen. And then they continued to fast and pray and then laid hands on them and sent them forth. This wasn't a fly-by-night thing. This wasn't a thing where, you come in, got a little zeal, somebody's going to prophesy over you right into the ministry. Folks, if you're not, can I say something about ministry? If you're not called, you don't want to do it. Numerous reasons. Number one, if you're not called, you're going to just end up in trouble. Right. Number two, if you're not called, you're going to mess folk up. Amen. And I don't care who prophesied over you. If you don't know you're called, don't go. I've seen people try to prophesy people into the ministry. I've seen people prophesy people into marriage. And I believe in the gift of prophecy, and I believe in the manifestation of prophecy, and I believe in the word of knowledge and the word of wisdom. I believe God does use those manifestations of the Spirit to minister to people and to help people and to guide people who already know where they're headed. Amen. Or have a sense of some things, and God confirms it. But you just can't call people into something just because you think that's what they should do. I've seen it. Remember one couple, we first came to Greensboro, had been married, we found out later, they got married because some girl in the church laid hands on them and called them together in Jesus' name. They had nothing but trouble day one. They're divorced. I said, they're divorced. Now, they both loved the Lord, both had a desire to follow the things of God, but then somebody came along and prophesied over them, you're supposed to get married, so they got married because somebody prophesied over them. That's like Pastor Hagin used to say, we used to have a class called Marriage and Family. I think they still have Marriage and Family. And he always in that class would talk about the man and marry the woman who could enhance his ministry. Said she could play the piano and sing, and she could enhance his ministry again. He needed a singing piano player so he could work in the ministry. And said about 3 weeks after they got married, he's sitting there at the morning table reading the newspaper, and he dropped the newspaper and looked across the table and looked at that woman and realized, sing, woman, sing! Because when he looked at her, he realized he didn't marry her because he thought she was beautiful, didn't marry her because he was attracted to her, he married her because she could sing and play the piano and say, remind me why I married you, sing, woman, sing. Those are stupid reasons. You don't do things based on reasons other than marriage, listen, you young people, and you old people. There's some old folk got less sense than young people. You don't marry somebody you have no attraction to. That's carnal. Yeah, and you got a flesh and bone body. She ought to stir you, men. You keep your passions down when you're not married, but you got to be stirred. Lord have mercy. It's all a spiritual relationship. Hogwash! Behave yourself. When you think about I want a spiritual man, I want a spiritual woman, I want them to be, walk in water, and I want them to cast out devils, and that's all great. But you better be attracted to them too. And I remember we had a friends. Sometimes friendships don't last, but at the time they were friends, and they got married, and she'd wear all this makeup, this mask in the morning, sleep in and stuff, that stuff. And one day he you don't tell your wife this, men, just marriage counseling. Your wife don't roll over and you say, "Go, honey, go put your face on." Guess what they are today? Divorced. Happily divorced. Probably so. No. Somebody come prophesying somebody because they think you ought to get together. Man, if she don't stir your blood and he don't give you butterflies, you better start backing them thinking about it. Well, that's making it a carnal relationship. God gave you a flesh and bone body, and he gave you emotions, and he gave you feelings for a reason. And it's not wrong to be passionate about the person you love. Now, what's wrong is not controlling it until you're married. Then when you get married, you can just let her go. Let her rip. And then go for it for the rest of your life.
Let her rip.
Dance a yes.
Oh, yeah.
Hallelujah. All right. Nathan, stop. Let's not take this too far down. But you get people prophesying over people, and they don't even like each other. But I'm supposed to marry him because brother so-and-so prophesied. What makes brother so-and-so Cupid? And besides, we don't follow Cupid anyway. Cupid can draw back his bow and let his arrow go. But I'm telling you right now, just because brother so-and-so prophesied it don't mean you got to obey it. As a matter of fact, if he prophesied it and you're not in there with liking somebody, you better not. Because you're going to end up in divorce court. Miserable divorce court and everything else you can think of. Because somebody prophesied. I'm going to tell you something. We call it prophecy. It ain't prophecy. You know what it was? Fleshicide. They were speaking over you what their opinion, what they thought. We got to be led by the Spirit of God. Anybody embarrassed? Yeah, show me embarrassed. Janice is excited. Yeah, go for it. Need to be, do what? All right. I know churches, they put people together because the pastor sounds like something like God. Everybody worships him like he's a God. I never told Janice and Jerry they're supposed to get married. I thought it. Everybody in the church thought it. But I'm going to tell you something. No matter what, until Jerry knew that Jerry was supposed to marry Janice, there wasn't no need in saying anything. Why? Because if tough times show up, he'd be coming and say, "Pastor, you told me I was supposed to marry that woman. Look what happened." Now he ain't coming to me and say, "Pastor, I married that woman. Now look what happened." And I'm going to say, "That's your fault." Can't put that back off on me. You knew it was God when you did it. And we just need to tease them because it's such a long and winding road. Praise God. But the Holy Ghost said, how did I get off on a marriage seminar in the middle of that? But you young people, I hear, I'm, Some of you people went to the same Bible school I went to, and you're listening to me. Now, I know pastor talks like this. But you stop looking for Mr. Super Spiritual who walked on water when he got the rhema. If you're not attracted to them, forget it. And if brother so-and-so prophesied, run. The pastor of that church is pastor so-and-so. You know who I'm talking about. You go talk to him or somebody like that. He ain't going to tell you, are you attracted to him? Well, not really. Then run. Don't. But they're spiritual. So stinking what? That may be all they are. They don't have no time for you because they're too busy being spiritual. There's nothing wrong with being spiritual, but if you're married, you got a spouse you're supposed to take care of. Amen. You're their spouse. I didn't mean to make a marriage seminar out of this. But you got natural things have to be taken care of. They want you to go on a date. I know one guy said, I know a pastor one time said that him and his wife are engaged in relationships. They pray in the spirit. Now, I'll be honest with you, that's about the flakiest thing I've ever heard. Praying in the spirit is communion between you and God. Relationships are communion between you and your spouse. Hello. I don't have any Bible evidence you're supposed to do that. Oh, yeah, that's real spiritual. We done all got ourselves in a hole. We'll see y'all next week. I'm trying to get back out of this one. Call deeper. I'm on this because people prophesying over people to get married, and it's not God. Because it's, you know, and they go get married. Next thing you know, they got all kinds of trouble in the house. Because they did find out that the super spiritual person they married to is human. Hello? They got flesh, and they got carnal, they got mind, they got all kinds, they got a body. And you folks that are married, don't go so spiritual you can't be with your spouse. Spend time with them. Amen. Matter of fact, the Bible speaks against that. You have to defraud one another. Well, I just jumped in there a little bit deeper. We're not to defraud one another. You know, except for a time of when you set aside the time for fasting and prayer, and don't make it too long lest you be tempted. That's Bible. Not this weird, ooh. We don't need a bunch of Casper the Ghost in the church. We need men and women who are led by the Spirit, who walk with God, who walk according to God, and take care of all their other areas of life they need to take care of. I'll just back off of that one now, because y'all just gotten quieter and quieter and quieter. It's funny for a second. Now you go, oh, God, I'm going to shut up. Oh, Lord, have mercy. You young folks, listen to me. I know what I'm talking about. Go. I've seen too much of it. I've seen too many people get married, and then you find out later they're all divorced. And but they all thought they were supposed to do it because everybody was laying hands and prophesying and saying it's God and all this kind. Listen, if people are telling you it's God, then forget just marriage, anything. It's God, and you don't have a witness of it, you better leave it alone. I had a girl come to church one time. She used to come here, but she also went to our home church that we were out of in Greenville. And she was from here. She had gone to East Carolina. And, you know, if you remember back in the early 80s and mid-80s, well, before that even, East Carolina was known as, at one time, ranked as, well, they stopped ranking them as party schools because they said they were experts. It wasn't fair to rank them anymore. I mean, they thought that was awesome. Well, you know, the GPA to get in was 700 back then. I mean, not GPA, the SAT was 700. You get in East Carolina was 700. And, huh? Yeah, write your name on it. There you go. And it was a party school. And this girl came down, and ended up at one of our campus outreaches and got saved. And that messed up your party school. And So she, you know, she when she was home, she'd come visit here, you know, and that kind of thing, because we had the relationship with this, you know, the church there. And she went out to Florida one time, went to the school, and they were prophesying everybody, the school of the prophets. And they laid hands on her and said she was going to marry this guy, and they were all going to go to the nations, and they were going to do this, going to do that, you know. And so she brought me the tape. She wouldn't know what I thought. So I listened to it. And I just asked her, you know, because this is a really good question to ask people. I said, before you heard this, before they laid hands on you, you said all this, had you ever thought you would do any of those things they said? She said, no. I said, then what you need to do is you need to put this on the shelf and forget about it. Yeah, but that was prophet. So I said, no, you don't understand. If you don't have it in your heart, it doesn't matter who it was that said it. You put it on the shelf and leave it alone. And if God brings it to your heart, you can pick it up again. Amen. But unless that, you need to put it on the shelf. Amen. Why? Because you're not being led by the Spirit. You're being led by what prophet so-and-so said. You got to be led by the Spirit. Amen. She didn't like my answer. So she picked up her tape. She drove all the way to Greenville. She made an appointment with my pastor, Pastor John. Went in to see him. Told her that she'd come to see me. Played me the tape. She played him the tape. He said, well, what did Ed say? He told me to put it on the shelf. He looked at it and said, sounded like he gave good advice to me. 6 hours of driving just to get the same thing. See, because what happens when the flesh gives stuff, it ministers or incites the desire of the flesh to do something that's fleshly. But see, we have to be led by the Spirit and incited by the Spirit to follow after the Spirit. That's a choice. Amen. As far as I know, she never did any of it. But, you know, because I know that because my pastor called me and told me what happened. Yeah, I told her, well, you know, she could have saved herself a lot of money, a lot of gas. But if we teach you to learn that the Spirit of God speaks to you, and when somebody says something over you that you've never even envisioned, never had in your heart, there's no vision of it in you, you can't walk in it. You cannot walk in it. You have to walk and be led by the Spirit. Now, it could be that God gives you some of that at some point in time, and when he does, you can pick it up and walk in it. But he has to give it. I said, he has to give it. Are you here? You're going home. And when he gives, see, what? Why? Remember Abraham. Look over in Romans, the 4th chapter. Romans chapter 4. We'll start here, verse 16. Therefore, it is of faith that it might be by grace to the end the promise might be sure to all the seed. Not to only that which is of the law, but to that which also is of faith, the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made the father of many nations, before whom he believed, even God who quickeneth the dead and calls those things which be not as though they were. Who against hope believed in hope that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. God gave him a word. God gave him a word to his spirit. Now, I'm all for somebody having a word that confirms what God's spoken to you. I watched Dad Hagin. He'd say, so-and-so, come here. And he starts now, I believe the Lord showed me. Now, listen, I can miss it, and you tell me if I missed it. You know, I'm human. I can make a mistake. He'd tell him, I've seen him do it. Brother Hagin, yeah, I saw Brother Hagin do it. More than once. I can miss it, but I believe the Lord showed me you're supposed to do such and this. And they go, yeah, that's right. That's exactly right. That's exactly right. He's been telling us, talking to us. But I appreciate the fact he'd tell him, I can miss it. If it's not God, don't you do it. Because I'm not the infallible prophet. Only thing we know that's infallible is the Word and the Holy Ghost. Not us. We're vessels. We can make mistakes. I said, we can make mistakes. We can believe God speaking to us and it not be God. We can have an opinion so strong. So, and that's why we have to be careful. Before we run around and start spouting off to everybody, the Lord's telling you to do such and such. It's kind of like, it's so easy to tell other people to go do stuff and you not do it. Are you here? But you got to know. I said, you got to know. And when you know, and then the word of the Lord comes, or somebody ministers to you by the word of wisdom or word of knowledge, by prophecy, boy, that can confirm it. And you can just go on, yeah, I'm hearing from God. Oh, I'm hearing what the Lord's saying. The Spirit of God's speaking to my spirit. What happens then? More faith gets real strong. And you can go out and step out in faith and not step out in somebody else's whatever. So those of us, when you're ministering to somebody, if you're going to give them a word, make sure you say, look, if this doesn't bear witness with your heart, don't act on it. I believe the Lord's saying this. And give them the out so that if you are missing it, they don't feel the pressure to do it because they have so much respect for you and thank you that, you know, you hear from heaven so well. It gives them an out to go, you know what, you know, you're right. You know, I really don't think, God hadn't spoke to me about that. And don't be so prideful. Yeah, he is. I know he is. Back up and go, well, you know what? You know, I could have missed it. Or it could be for later on. So, you know, praise God. We'll just love the Lord and go on. People have more respect for you in the long run than if you'll find that you didn't know what you're talking about. Amen. It's so important that we as individuals grow and become led by the Spirit. Well, what about the people who are immature?
They have pastors.
The shepherd of the sheep is there to watch over their soul. And if you're not the pastor, you need to, you need to take them to the pastor and let him watch over their soul as they grow. You might have a word. I can judge it. I can stand there and, you know, with you and go, well, you know, praise the Lord, and ask the questions and walk through it. Don't have to be done in secret. I wouldn't plan on stopping this for, but I tell you, we got hung up here. We're going to stay here until we quit. The inward witness. See, even as young Christians, you can know, you can not understand what it is, but God's leading and guiding you because you just have an unction. Amen. Just the other day, and then you get older, and then you sometimes get lazy and stop listening to the Holy Ghost, then you start listening to him again. I know the other day I was just out, I was somewhere and I was at the grocery store and we had to upgrade our phones. We just hadn't have any choice. They had to be upgraded. Of course, you get them upgraded for free. So we were doing that, but the Verizon was out. Said it'd be 3 to 5 weeks. We ain't gonna get any more. You know, you got to do that. And this went on and on and on. And I was at the grocery store and I tell you, I just had an unction. There's a retail store over there by Moe's. So I walk in and I kind of went, you guys probably don't have any more iPhones. Oh yeah, we got a bunch of them. People don't know we're here, so we got plenty of them. I'm your man. Let's buy them. Just a slight unction. I didn't have, angels didn't get in my car. I mean, I didn't feel vibrations on the steering wheel. You know, I mean, I'm not against God having an experience, but I just had an unction to go do that. Janie had an unction the other day. She said, I need to check. She said, all of a sudden she had this unction that she'd been overpaying the storage on our camper. But we're planning on going to a short vacation, like a 4-day vacation over the next weekend. And we were getting ready to cancel because we didn't have the money. And so I called the campground and said, you know, my wife thinks we've been overpaying on the storage fee. They went, oh, yeah, you have. You're paid up through next summer sometime. I said, can we credit that back and pay for our vacation? Yeah. She just had an unction to go look and find out that she'd set up twice and the bill pay didn't realize it. It was so much that our whole thing's paid for. We're like, hallelujah. Vacation's back on. Glory to God. It's just an unction. Didn't have a voice. You know, didn't have an angel walk in the room. I am the angel, and I hear tell you, you've overpaid. The greatest and number one way God's going to lead you is through the inward witness or the inward unction. We could call it a premonition. It's not a premonition the way the world thinks of it, but just a knowing on the inside. That's the number one way God speaks to you. Yeah, but I heard so-and-so's testimony. And you know when the angel walked in? Those are rare. The Bible didn't say they're led by the angels. As a matter of fact, if you want to be real honest about it, and I don't mean this demeaning, in a lot of cases when angels are appearing, it's because the people won't listen any other way. Not every case. But in a lot of ways, when you have those kind of manifestations, it's because they just wouldn't listen any other way. Or there's something so imperative and so important that God had to make sure it got right. Like, you know, Brother Hagin's book, I Believe in Visions. There were some things about faith and about the things of God over the next century or 50 years or so that had to be taken care of and had to be done right then, had to be right. Okay? But yes, that's not the main way. God, we're not led by angels primarily. You don't have angels showing up primarily. The number one way, everybody say the number one way, is the inward knowing or inward witness. Or as they call it in the Old Testament, the still small voice. That's how God primarily leads you. Stop overriding that. Now, let me say something. In order to be hearing the still small voice, you got to get quiet sometime. You got to settle things down. You can't be rocking out to a Christian jam all the time. You're going to have to turn around and get some peace and quiet around so you can tune into the inward witness and hear the voice of God. You can get so cluttered up with so many other things, you're not hearing God. What did God say? Be still and know I'm God. There are times we need to settle. Everybody say settle. That's why I love the ability to pray in the Holy Ghost. Because praying in the Spirit can calm your mind and calm your flesh and calm your spirit and get you into a state where you can hear with clarity the still small voice. We need to be at peace and in spiritual calm. Can you say amen? It can't always be a ruckus going on. That went over big. I did. Now I'll say it again. You need to get at peace and quiet. Be still and know He's God. Let Him speak to us in the still small voice. Settle the activity around you down. Amen. Get at peace. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Calm yourself by praying in the Spirit. Get into that spiritual place of rest. And then listen, sometimes you're just going to have to shut up at that point. Some people don't know how to let God talk. They go into prayer and it's a one-way street. Well, God, I need this, I need that, I need this, here's what I want, here's what's going on, blah, 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 see you later, bow, and they're out. And He's going up, up, up. You ever talk to somebody who every time you're saying something, they just keep right on going right over top of you? You ever had that happen? They interrupt you everything you got to say? Finger pointing in church is not allowed. She's still my daughter. She might be your wife. She's still my daughter. She carries my DNA. Look at that mouth and nose. Anyway, hallelujah. When you get with God, you're going to spend time where you just get silent. That's why it's good to pray in the Holy Ghost and calm your mind and calm your flesh. Why? Because if you go in sometimes silent, you got all these things running around. Anybody ever had this much stuff running around in your mind? Huh? Yeah. You can't hear anything because your mind's just going. It's good to get at peace. Get into the presence of God and get calmed. And say, okay, Lord, now, what have you got to say? And hear Him. Hear the inner witness. The inner unction. Then you say, okay, Lord, I got it. Now, when God speaks, you can act on it. Amen? Hallelujah.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fbc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.